Thank you, Badri. Professor Harshay and friends, my lecture is entitled Gandhi the Environmentalist. But I'm going to begin by speaking of Govind Ballabh Pant the Environmentalist. This is a lecture in memory of the great patriot and institution builder Govind Ballabh Pant, after whom this institute is named. Former Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh, former Home Minister of the Government of India, and a close associate of Gandhi and of Nehru. But it's little known that he himself made some early and quite significant, though now forgotten, contributions to environmental thinking in India. And like everyone here, I knew of Pant as a freedom fighter when I was growing up. But in the course of my research on the history of forests in Kumaon, I came across an extraordinary tract he wrote, Pant wrote, called The Forest Problem in Kumaon. Now, the context of this tract is important. Those of you who have traveled in Uttarakhand, in Garhwal and Kumaon, know that it's a mountainous region with very rich forest cover. And the forests play a very important ecological role because they stabilize the soil, they enhance biodiversity, they maintain the microclimate, they prevent floods. They play a very important ecological role. But they also play an equally vital social role because the agriculture of the hills is absolutely dependent on the forests. Historically, it's been totally dependent on the forests, that the peasants of Garhwal and Kumaon get leaf manure for their fields from the forest, their homes are built of wood from the forest, their agricultural implements come from the forest, their cattle go and graze in the forest. They get medicinal plants from the forest. Traditionally, in times of famine and food scarcity, the fruits, the herbs, the tubers would provide succor for the peasants and save them from destitution and death. So the forests have played an absolutely crucial role in the ecological and social life of the peasantry of the Himalaya. However, these forests are also extremely valuable commercially. And from the 19th century, the British colonial state began a process where they took over the forests, constituted them as state reserves, kept the local residents out, and exploited these forests for wood, for resin, and other commercial purposes. And this blatant injustice led to a major peasant movement in 1921, demanding that the government get out of the forests. Now, this movement was 50 years before the Chipko Andolan. The Chipko Andolan, which was also born in the Uttarakhand Himalaya in the 1970s, took up this issue about local rights over forests and essentially systematically. The Chipko movement was a movement that had these three aims: one, restore the forest to the control of the local community, and secondly, make sure that the forests are preserved for ecological reasons. And Pant had anticipated this in his remarkable pamphlet called The Forest Problem of Kumaon. And in this pamphlet, I'm just going to quote you a little bit, because I'll come to Gandhi in a moment, but allow me to tell you things about Pant that have been forgotten. In this pamphlet he wrote, and I quote, "The spacious wooded areas extending over the mountain ranges bear testimony to the care bestowed by the successive generations of Kumaonis. A natural system of conservancy was in vogue. Almost every hilltop is dedicated to some local deity, and the trees on the spot are regarded with great respect. There is also a general impression among the people that everyone cutting a tree should plant another in its place." Now, this is the folk culture of Kumaon. "Anyone cutting a tree should plant another in its place. Grass and fodder reserves are maintained Special care is taken by villagers to plant and preserve trees on the edges of their fields. Then Pant argues in this pamphlet that rather than the government managing the forests, forests should be under the control of village panchayats or local communities, and he says that this will lead to a sense of responsibility from within. If you cultivate a sense, an ethic of responsibility, whereby local communities manage their forests, rather than being treated as enemies by the government, the forest department takes over the forest and treats local people as their enemies. So, this is quite a remarkable pamphlet by Pant. Now, it's another matter that he forgot about all this in his later career. You know, when he became a freedom fighter and he became chief minister of UP, he did little to restore the control of the forest back to the village people. But in the history of environmental thought in India, Gandhi occupies a major place, and I'll come to Gandhi in a minute, and I'll explain why we should regard Gandhi as a pioneer of environmental thinking in India. But in that history of environmental thought, a minor footnote should also be accorded to the subject after whom this lecture is named. Now, with those few prefatory remarks about Pant, let me come to Gandhi. Now, in a few weeks, we'll be marking Gandhi's birthday, and it's been a rather special birthday. October 2nd, 2018 will mark the 149th birth anniversary of Gandhi. We'll be entering the 150th year of his birth, and there'll be all kinds of celebrations all across India and all across the world. And these celebrations, you can be sure, will focus on three fundamental aspects of Gandhi's legacy. First, his invention of the technique of protest called satyagraha. You know, Badri talked about the struggle against injustice. And part of Gandhi's great innovation was to say, one must never use arms against the oppressor. Violence begets more violence. If you are oppressed, if you are a community of landless laborers, if you are a colonized people like India was in the 1920s, if you are women persecuted by men, if you are Dalits oppressed by high castes, by all means resist it, but resist it non-violently through satyagraha. So that's one fundamental contribution of Gandhi to the modern world. The second is his lifelong battle against caste and gender distinctions. The French sociologist Louis Dumont wrote a book in which he called Indians homo hierarchicus. This was written in the 1960s. Homo hierarchicus. No other culture or civilization had so perfected hierarchy as Indians. Now, Indians are fond of celebrating the good things they did. You know, we hear all the time about our invention of the zero and our imaginary invention of plastic surgery and so on. Now, like most patriotic people, we like to own the good things that we give in the world, but we should also recognize some of the nasty things we've given the world, and we were homo hierarchicus. No other culture or civilization had so elaborately divided people according to caste and gender. And Gandhi spent his whole life struggling against caste and gender distinctions. So Gandhi was a prophet of nonviolent resistance to unjust authority. He was a lifelong advocate for the equality of all people, regardless of caste and gender and class. And finally, Gandhi believed passionately and fervently in Hindu-Muslim harmony, and he gave his life for it. So in this 150th year celebrations of Gandhi, doubtless these three contributions of Gandhi will be talked about. The theory and practice of satyagraha will be talked about. The continuing struggle to end caste and gender discrimination will be talked about. The vital importance of preserving religious and linguistic pluralism in a country like India will be talked about. And while absolutely underlining these three fundamental contributions of Gandhi's thought, I want to focus on a fourth, less known contribution of Gandhi to the world, his environmental ideas. And I'm going to do so by going directly to his writings. I have spent the last decade and a half working on a biography of Gandhi. The second volume will be out next week. And in the course of the research for this biography, I have read and reread the 90 volumes of Gandhi's collected works. And in this study of Gandhi's writings, the first intimations of what we may call an environmental sensibility occurs in an article of April 1913. This was a time when Gandhi was still in South Africa. He was based first in Durban, in the province of Natal, and then later in Johannesburg, in the province of Transvaal, working for the rights of the Indian diaspora. And he ran a magazine called Indian Opinion. You know, there's so many, as I go along, you'll have to be prepared for different digressions, because I've spent the last 20 years immersed in Gandhi, and there's so many aspects of his life that are so extraordinary. For example, he starts this journal called Indian Opinion. Now, many people start journals to promote, you know, their own political philosophy or ideology. And many great nationalists did it too. With Tilak ran a journal, Ambedkar ran a journal. Motilal Nehru in this city started a newspaper. Now, Motilal Nehru's newspaper was in English. Tilak's newspaper, Motilal Nehru's newspaper, which is called Independent, was in English. Tilak's newspaper, which was published from Pune, was in English and in Marathi. It was called Kesari. Gandhi ran a newspaper in four languages: English, Hindi, Tamil, and Gujarati. It may have been the first multilingual newspaper in the world. So he was this is one of the odd ways in which he was a pioneer. And in this newspaper in 1913, he wrote a fascinating, if now forgotten, essay on the contrast between the city dweller and the villager. The contrast between the city dweller and the villager with respect to how they viewed the natural world. So here is Gandhi in 1913, 105 years ago, telling us how the farmer differs from the townsman. Of course, he differs in many ways. He practices agriculture, not industry. He lives in a small settlement, not in a large settlement, and so on and so forth. But Gandhi underlines one less remarked upon distinction between the townsman and the farmer. Here is what he says, and I quote. This is a long quote from Gandhi, but please bear with me. This is how the quote begins. A farmer cannot work without applying his mind. He must be able to test the nature of his soil, must watch changes of weather, must know how to manipulate his plow skillfully, and be generally familiar with the movements of the stars, the sun, and the moon. However clever a city dweller may be, however many degrees he may have from modern universities, every time a city dweller goes to a farmer's house, he feels altogether out of his element. The farmer can say how seed should be sown. By looking at the stars, he can judge the distance even at night. He can make certain deductions from the voice and speed of birds. For instance, when certain birds sing or cluster together, he sees in it a sign of the approach of the monsoon. Thus, the farmer knows enough of astronomy, geography, and geology to serve his needs. I repeat, thus, the farmer knows enough of astronomy, geography, and geology to serve his needs. He has to feed his children and has, therefore, some ideas of the duties of man. And residing as he does in the vast open spaces of this earth, he becomes aware of the greatness of God. Physically, he is always sturdy. He is his own physician when ill. Thus, we can see the farmer has an educated mind. End of quote. Now, this is Gandhi, so there's a spiritual angle. He's saying that the villager is more devout than the townsperson. But that's not the important part of this quote. The important part of this quote is saying, is Gandhi's insistence that you and me in the city regard the farmer as illiterate, but he is far from that. He knows astronomy, geology, soil science, climate, forest, bird life. He has an intimate knowledge of the land, the seasons, that makes him in some respects more educated than the townsman. He is more connected to nature. The farmer is more connected to nature than urban people like me. And because he is more connected to nature, he's also more equipped to take care of nature and natural resources in a responsible, in an ethical, and in a far-sighted way. Now, when Gandhi wrote this in 1913, he had been out of India for more than 20 years. He left India in 1893 to settle a legal dispute in South Africa, and he stayed there 2 decades. He came back in 1915, and most of you will know that when he asked his mentor, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, for advice, Gokhale told him, don't speak on politics for 1 year, travel around the countryside, get to know this country. Now, he'd been away from India for more than 2 decades. And even before that, when he was in India as a student in Kathiawar, and briefly as a lawyer in Mumbai, he had only lived in towns. He had never actually lived in the countryside. So he spends that year, 1915, traveling around India, getting to know the ecological, social, cultural, political diversity of India. And for a full year, he doesn't speak on politics at all. It's an extraordinary limitation he sets on himself. He says, I have been away for India for more than 20 years. I want to make an impact in this country. Gandhi is clear when he comes back from South Africa in 1915. He's clear that he's come back to make a career in politics. You know, Gandhi was an intensely ambitious man. In South Africa, he was only the leader of the 120,000 Indian migrants in South Africa. He's come back here to become the leader of 300 million Indians. He has that political ambition. But he says, I cannot lead these people unless I understand them. So he spends the whole year traveling around India, and he continues to travel around India for the rest of his life. There is a lovely book written by a remarkable, little-known Gandhian scholar called Chandu Bhai Dalal, C.B. Dalal. It's called Day to Day with Gandhi, Gandhi, a Chronology. And it tells you from the time he came back in January 1915 till his death in January 1948, every single day of Gandhi's life is tracked. And it's extraordinary how much he traveled. His home was a second-class railway compartment. That was his home. And through those travels across the length and breadth of India, and there is nowhere he did not go. He must have come to Allahabad 8 times, Banaras 15 times. You know, he went all over the place. Tamil Nadu, Andhra, Northwest Frontier Province, Punjab, Uttarakhand, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Orissa, Assam. And often traveling in the most, what we would today we would consider, those of you who are used to air travel, would consider the most primitive and backward means of communication. He traveled when he went to Champaran for the first time in 1917. The only way he could go was by elephant. When he went to Bengal in 1945, East Bengal, the only way he could go was by boat. When he went to Bengal the next year, after the Hindu-Muslim violence in Noakhali, the only way he could travel was walking at the age of 75 or 77. So he was continuously traveling and soaking in what he was seeing. So his understanding of this country came from a profound, in-depth immersion with the people. Apart from his, and he traveled all across India, and yet he felt, I don't know India well enough. So in 1934, he left Ahmedabad, where he had had an ashram, which some of you would have visited, on the banks of the Sabarmati River, and said, I want to live in a village. So he went to the middle of India, Sevagram, a remote part of the central provinces, and established an ashram there. Now, from all these travels across India, Gandhi came to the conclusion that it would be impossible for India to emulate Western styles, Western patterns of industrial development. I repeat, from his travels across India, Gandhi came to the conclusion that it would be impossible for India to emulate Western patterns of industrial development. I am a resident of the state of Karnataka, and a person in Karnataka we are very proud of is the engineer statesman M. Vishwesharaya. And Vishwesharaya once said, addressing his fellow Indians, he said, industrialize or perish. And Gandhi answered, industrialize and perish. Now, this skepticism about industrial society that Gandhi had, and he had it from very early on, it's expressed in his 1909 tract, Hind Swaraj, as well. This skepticism about industrial society is usually interpreted as having based on morality. Townspeople are greedy, capitalists are greedy. Industrial society leads to, some kind of manic desire to accumulate wealth. So it's a moral reservation that he had about industrial society, is the common interpretation. But I'm going to give you a complementary interpretation, not a rival interpretation, but a complementary interpretation. Gandhi was someone who lived simply. He abhorred the desire to conquer distance through speed. He abhorred the human tendency to acquire more and more possessions. So there was a moral component to his critique of industrialization, but, and this is the important point of my lecture today, there was also an ecological or environmental reason for him to oppose Western-style industrialization. Take, for example, this remarkable passage from his journal, Young India, of 20th December 1928, 90 years ago. 90 years ago, Gandhi writes, and this is this quote that I'm going to read out to you is the core of my whole lecture. It's only about 40 words, but it's the core of my whole lecture. So I'll read it once, I'll read it again, and then I'll provide my interpretation. So here is Gandhi writing in his journal, Hind Swaraj, on 20th December 1928. God forbid that India ever take to industrialization after the manner of the West. The economic imperialism of a single tiny island kingdom, namely England, is today keeping the world in chains. If an entire nation of 300 million took to similar economic exploitation, it would strip the world bare like locusts. I'm going to read this again. God forbid that India take to industrialization after the manner of the West. Today, 1928, the economic imperialism of a single tiny island kingdom, namely England, is keeping the world in chains. If a country of 300 million, which is what India was then, takes to similar economic exploitation, it would strip the world bare like locusts. Now, Gandhi says, and this is, it's important to understand the nuances here, he says, God forbid that India take to industrialization after the manner of the West. And I will submit to you, though mine is admittedly a motivated reading, I would submit to you that the key words are after the manner of the West, not industrialization per se. There could be alternative routes to industrialization, alternative routes to economic development. Gandhi was as concerned as Vishwesharaya or Nehru or any of us today that mass poverty had to be removed. Gandhi was absolutely clear that every single Indian must have access to clean water, a good house, safe transportation, good education, and dignified employment. He did not romanticize backwardness, poverty, illiteracy, caste prejudice. But he, being a precocious environmentalist, asked, can India industrialize in the same way as the West did? Gandhi said, at the same time as he made this quote, he said, can we make India like England or America? To make India, like England or America, is to find some other races and places of the world to exploit. England and America had industrialized the way they did because they'd colonized vast continents. The economic imperialism of England, said Gandhi in 1928, is keeping the world in chains. America was able to industrialize because Europeans went to this vast and beautiful continent, exterminated the Native Americans, and then embarked on their process of industrial growth. So, to make, this is Gandhi saying, to make India like England and America is to find some other races and the places of the world to exploit. But since the Western nations had already divided the known races outside Europe for exploitation, there are no new worlds to discover. What can be the fate of India trying to ape the West? Now, Europe and America had already divided the known places and races of the world. What can be the fate of India if it tries to ape the West? This is Gandhi in 1928. And in 2018, I tell you, it is very clear what can be the fate of India in trying to ape the West. We have tried, contrary to Gandhi's warnings, we have tried to make India like England and America. We have embarked on industrialization after the manner of the West. And without the access to resources and markets enjoyed by England and America when they began to industrialize, India has had to rely on the exploitation of its own people and environments. Our industrial development is based on our exploitation of the less populated, resource-rich, politically vulnerable and marginal regions of India. Without the Northeast, without the Central Indian heartland, without the Uttarakhand Himalaya, India cannot industrialize on the manner of the West. And this form of industrialization has left environmental and social devastation in its wake. One reason why the Uttarakhand floods of 2013 were so devastating was because of deforestation, mining, careless road widening, and the like. If any of you have traveled, as I have, through places like Chhattisgarh and Orissa, you will see the colossal damage to the environment and to Adivasi life that mining has brought, unregulated mining has brought about. Gandhi would not have been surprised by how, by attempting to industrialize after the manner of the West, we have only promoted a kind of internal colonization, where certain resource-rich, less populated, and politically weak parts of India, such as the Adivasi areas of central India, such as the Himalaya, such as the Northeast, and such as the Andamans, have provided a disproportionate amount of resources to sustain the lifestyles of all of us in this room. In 1935, Gandhi was giving a talk in Indore, and like I'm giving a talk now in Allahabad. And in this talk, he says, you see, Gandhi had this ability to capture a whole swathe of historical and social processes in two sentences, or one sentence. You know, I think to read Gandhi is also to learn how to write economically and not to waste words. And here is what he's saying in 1935 while he's giving a talk in Indore. And he says, we are sitting in this pandal under a blaze of electric lights. But we do not know that we are burning these lights at the expense of the poor. Now, that was Gandhi the environmentalist at a philosophical level, at a theoretical level. Someone who recognized that the massive urban and industrial conglomerations of the West had been enabled by their access to resources from all across the world. And here he was warning us in his own intuitive way in the 1920s that if we wanted to grow economically, we had to adopt different kinds of methods. Now, from this diagnosis of the ills of centralized industrialization, Gandhi offered a model of decentralized economic growth. He said, I want to see the blood that is today inflating the arteries of the cities run again in the blood vessels of the villages. When he was accused, when Gandhi was accused of turning his back on the great scientific inventions, including electricity, Gandhi replied in words that should inspire all proponents of decentralized energy, he replied, if we could have electricity in every village home, I would not mind villagers plying their implements and tools with the help of electricity. But then the village communities of the state would own powerhouses, just as they own their grazing pastures. I mentioned earlier in my talk that in 1934, Gandhi moved to a village home in central India. Shortly after he moved, a villager from Birbhum in Bengal asked him, wrote him a letter saying, what is your ideal village? And Gandhi replied in the pages of his newspaper. He said, my idea, this is a very moving description of a self-sufficient, ecologically responsible, and socially just village. So it's a utopian kind of vision, but it's still a very lovely vision, so I'll read it out to you. This is Gandhi defining his ideal village in the year 1937. My ideal village will have cottages with sufficient light and ventilation, built of a material obtainable within a radius of 5 miles. The cottages will have courtyards enabling householders to plant vegetables for domestic use and to house their cattle. The village lanes and streets will be free of all avoidable dust. The village will have wells according to its needs and accessible to all. It will have a common meeting place, a village common for grazing its cattle, a cooperative dairy, primary and secondary schools in which vocational training will be provided, and it will have panchayats for settling disputes. It will produce its own grain, vegetables and fruit, and its own khadi. This is roughly my ideal of a model village. So here is Gandhi's agrarian utopia. Local self-reliance, a clean and hygienic environment, the collective management of those gifts of nature, water, forests, and pasture. Finally, Gandhi's philosophical critique of modern civilization also had profound implications for the way we live and relate to the environment today. For him, the distinguishing characteristic of modern civilization is an indefinite multiplication of wants. Gandhi said, I wholeheartedly detest this mad desire to destroy distance and time, to increase animal appetites, and go to the earths in search of their satisfaction. Now, Gandhi's own individual lifestyle was, as you know, minimalist. When he died, all he left behind was a staff, a loincloth, and a pair of spectacles. But there is a quote attributed to him, widely attributed to him, which goes, this world has enough for everybody's need, but not enough for everybody's greed. He actually never said that. You know, I won't call it fake news, but that is a misattribution. He never said that, though you could say that his philosophy and his lifestyle closely approximated that fake quotation. Now, I've tried to, so far in this lecture, what I've tried to do is to give you my understanding of the ways in which we could consider Gandhi an early environmentalist. The other things I could have said, for example, Gandhi was a very practical man. So he wrote a great deal about the dangers of chemical agriculture. One of the differences between China and India is that because of caste prohibitions, Indian farmers do not use human waste on the soil. So he said this is absurd, and human waste should also be used to fertilize the soil, apart from cattle dung. So whether you think of his broader understanding of processes of industrial development, his prescriptions for rural reconstruction, his personal ethic of living simply, his interest in appropriate technology, in all these respects, Gandhi's writings offer insights into the environmental crisis today. So Gandhi was indeed an urban was indeed a early and precocious environmentalist, as much as he was a proponent of interfaith harmony, of equality for women and Dalits, and of resolving disputes through non-violent means. But I'm going to end my talk by pointing to some of the limitations of Gandhi's thought when it comes to the environment. I'm going to point to the limitations of Gandhi's thought. I have argued that the historical figure of Gandhi provides a body of ideas that have proved critical to the environmental movement today. Gandhi was an early environmentalist in many respects, but could Gandhi provide all the answers to the environmental problems we face today? And I'm going to leave you with my views on two ways in which Gandhi's thought is limiting. For those of us in 2018, Gandhi's thought is limiting. The first way in which Gandhi's thought is limiting is that environmental thought is limiting. It is that it's completely focused on the countryside, on the village, on the agrarian sector, and on rural development. Gandhi famously said, India lives in her villages. You know, he said this in the 1930s. Now, India lives in her cities too. And India lives more and more in her cities. They probably, I don't know what the exact figures are, but there are probably 400 million Indians who live in cities. And soon we'll have the largest urban population in the world. And unfortunately, Gandhians like Gandhi have turned their back on the city. Gandhi exalted the village and turned his back on the city, and Gandhians have done the same. I spoke about the Chipko Andolan. The Chipko Andolan is one of two most celebrated environmental movements in India today, the second being the Narmada Bachao Andolan. And Gandhians and the leaders of the Chipko Andolan, Chandi Prasad Bhatt and Sundarlal Baghuna, were inspired by Gandhi. The leaders of the Narmada Bachao Andolan, Medha Patkar, inspired by Gandhi. But like Gandhi, contemporary environmentalists have turned their back on the city. Unfortunately, in their perhaps too literal identification with Gandhi, Indian environmentalists have yet to come to terms with the fact that India will soon have the largest urban population in the world. The consequences of such rapid and environmental urbanization are already with us. Massive pollution, overcrowding and the diseases associated with it, water shortages, inadequate housing and sanitation, and a system of transportation that is highly inefficient from an energy conservation and environmental point of view. In engaging with these problems and trying to make our cities and towns more habitable, in trying to improve and make more sustainable our systems of energy and transportation and housing, we can draw no inspiration from Gandhi. We'll have to look elsewhere. We'll have to look for other kinds of urban thinkers who wrote on environmental problems. So the city has no attraction for Gandhi. And in an interesting paradox, the wilderness has no attraction for Gandhi either. It is true that his practice of vegetarianism and non-violence oriented Gandhi towards a respect for all life. Yet by all accounts, he was hardly moved by the glories of unspoiled nature. You will not find in Gandhi what you will find in Nehru or Tagore. Beautiful lyrical passages about rivers and mountains and forests and bird life, you will not find that. You know, Gandhi was, in that sense, you know, an ascetic, profoundly uninterested in the beauty and diversity of nature. There is nothing of the romantic in Gandhi compared to Tagore and Nehru. Tagore and Nehru were, as I said, deeply appreciative of the natural beauty of India. And there's a near mystical quality in Nehru's invocation in his last will of his affinity with the soil, the mountains, and the rivers of India. Now, this is a lovely anecdote to illustrate this. Among the British friends of Indian freedom was a former missionary and teacher called Edward Thompson. Now, Edward Thompson was the father of the great historian E.P. Thompson, who is known to Rajan and Badri and some others in this room. But the father was an equally interesting man. He was a Wesleyan.